Alrighty then, for our first example, we've got x minus 3 is equal to 10. Now, in the previous lesson where we introduced, you know, just what an equation, you know, was, this would be an example where we would have done it with mental math. You know, what minus 3 is equal to 10? Well, I know it's 13, so the answer is 13. But, you know, what do you really need to do? What algebraic process do you need to go through solving this? Well, the addition property of equality, you want to undo, and by the way, here's the equal sign coming down and dividing the left and right hand sides of this equation. I'm identifying the variable as being on the left hand side, and with that variable of x, the unknown, we have a subtraction of 3. So if I want to solve for x, I want to completely isolate it, get it alone. I don't want any addition or subtraction with it. I don't want a number out front or any kind of division. I just want x equals and then whatever. So the inverse math operation of subtraction is addition. So we're going to add 3 to both sides of the equation. Negative 3 plus 3 is equal to 0. Your teacher may want to see that, or you can just cross those out knowing that they're going to add up to be 0. And when you add by 0, that's the identity for addition. Adding by 0 doesn't really change anything, so you don't need to show that plus 0. And we've got the x coming down. Again, the negative 3 plus 3 is 0. So we have x is equal to 10 plus 3, which is equal to 13. Now, the absolute wonderful thing about equations, when you do these on your quiz or on your test for your teacher, you can check your own work. You know, if you believe that 13 is the solution, then what that means is when you plug a solution into an equation, the two sides become equal. It becomes a true statement. So if we think that 13 is the answer, we can say, hey, let's check this. So we have 13 minus 3, does that indeed equal 10? And absolutely, yes it does. So this is our final answer, x is equal to 13. Now moving on to a one-step equation that maybe we can't do in our head, we have negative 7 is equal to, so here comes our equal sign, separating the left side from the right-hand side of our equation, and that negative 7 is equal to 2/3 plus x. Now, I do not know, you know, if I don't know off the top of my head that 2/3 plus some random number, well, it's not random, but I don't know what the number is, to make that equal negative 7. So we are indeed going to need to actually work this out, and don't grab the calculator as soon as you see a fraction, please. And another thing, 2 divided by 3, like, if you do struggle with fractions, and by the way, besides not being able to read a cooking book, not, you know, in other many day-to-day examples, here's a ruler. It's a yardstick. It goes from 1 to 36 inches, and between each of these inches, there's a bunch of little marks in between those inch values, and those marks indicate what? Fractions. So, if you want to build a frame, build a house, you know, make anything, measure anything, you need to know how to work with fractions, you know, just to get through day-to-day life, right? So stop making them into decimals, stop grabbing your calculator. If you do grab your calculator, 2 over 3, 2 divided by 3, yes, 2 divided by 3, that comes out to be 0.6 repeating. Well, some students will grab that on their calculator and write 0.67. They'll round that off, and that's nothing wrong with that. They might write 0.7. I don't know why I'm stuttering, but they might write 0.7. They might write 0.67. They might write 0.667. And that rounding off, with this fraction giving us a run-on decimal, that rounding off can, you know, lead us to get a wrong answer when everything that we did besides that rounding was correct. So work with those fractions. And what we're going to do is we're going to see that on the right-hand side where the variable is, we have a positive 2/3 x. That's an addition of 2/3 with the x on that side. We could also rewrite that as negative 7 is equal to x, and this, there's nothing in front of that 2/3, so that's plus 2/3. My x is positive, and my 2/3 is positive, and these are equivalent. There's no real reason to really switch these two terms on the right-hand side of this equation. Terms are separated by addition and subtraction, so there's 2 here. All I'm doing is trying to illustrate to you that that is a positive two-thirds or a plus two-thirds. So to undo that addition or that positive two-thirds on the right-hand side of this equation, we're going to do the inverse math operation, which is subtract. Now we have negative 7 minus two-thirds. And then on the right we have positive two-thirds minus two-thirds. Well, anything minus itself is going to come out to be 0. That's why we're introducing this inverse math operation. So on the right-hand side, we are just simply going to have x because that comes out to be 0. But maybe doing a little bit of scratch work on the side, how do you take negative 7 over 1 and subtract it with 2 over 3? Now notice instead of writing 7, I'm writing 7 over 1. Once you start working with fractions, I don't care if you multiply and dividing, adding and subtracting like we're doing here, you should make everything look like a fraction. So you can see the numerator and denominator with each of the items and probably terms that you are dealing with. You cannot add or subtract fractions unless you are unless you have common denominators. You want the lowest common multiple for the two denominators of those fractions. You want the lowest, you want that common denominator. So, I know I just said the same thing twice, but I realize I might have misspoke a bit. So, if I'm looking at our denominator of 1 and our denominator of 3, the multiples of 1, of course, are really just kind of counting by 1. And the multiples of 3, 3 times 1 is 3, 3 times 2 is equal to 6, 3 times 3 is 9, 3 times 4 is 12, and I'm counting, just really counting by 3. And I want to identify, you know, again, what is that lowest common multiple? Well, the multiple of 3 in that row starting with 1, the multiples of 1, that's the third number. I need to multiply 1 by 3 to get a common denominator. So we're going to introduce a multiple of 3 in the numerator and denominator of that first fraction. And that is going to give us negative 7 times 3 is negative 21 over 1 times 3 is equal to 3 minus 2 over 3. Now, why are we multiplying the numerator and denominator by the same value of 3? That fraction looks completely different, but 3 over 3, 3 divided by 3, anything divided by itself is equal to 1. So when I multiply by 1, like 5 times 1 is just 5, multiplying by 1 is the multiplicative identity. It doesn't change the value of what you're multiplying that 1 to. So I'm doing negative 7 over 1 and I'm multiplying it by 1 and I'm getting something that looks different, but I still just multiplied it by 1. So this has the same value. Negative 21 over 3 has the same value of negative 7 because, hey, negative 21 divided by 3 is negative 7. Now that we have those common denominators, we're going to combine those numbers on front, on just the numerator. So negative 21 minus 2, that's going to come out to be negative 23 over 3. Minus 21, or negative 21 minus 2 is the same thing as negative 21 plus a negative 2, if you like to see it that way. To give you the negative 23. You can also, again, of course, negative movements are a movement to the left on the number line. So if you're at 0 and you move left 21 units for negative 21, and then two more units to the left, left 21 and left another 2 units, you're going to be at negative 23 on the number line. So however you need to think about it, that is the result of doing negative 7 minus 2 thirds. That does come out to be negative 23 over 3. Now, turning this improper fraction into a mixed fraction, if your teacher would like to see the answer that way, is you want to think to yourself, well, okay, this is division, right? How many 3's are in 23? Well, that would be 7, right? 7 times 3 is 21. Take away the 21. That leaves you with a remainder of 2, and 3 will not go into 2. You would have to introduce a decimal and a zero and bring down the, you know, and bring down the zeros and start going into decimals, but I want a mixed fraction. So that is my remainder, and this is a mixed fraction, is negative 7 and 2 thirds is what is equal to x. Now, if I want to check my work, see if this is actually correct, again, all I got to do is take this, well, I don't want to work with the mixed fraction. Mixed fractions are wonderful for final answers. They're not good to work with, though. So if I want to check my answer, I'm going to go up here to negative 23 over 3. Notice I ignored that negative, by the way, as I went from improper form to mixed fraction form. Negative 7, this is my check. Negative 7 is equal to 2/3 minus 23 over 3. Well, that's going to be negative 7. I already have my common denominator of 3, so I can just copy that down and work with the top. 2 minus 23 is equal to 21. When you're combining numbers with different signs, you want to subtract those numbers and keep the sign of the largest absolute value, or basically 23 is bigger than 2, so that larger number is negative. So our final answer comes out to be negative 21. And negative 21 divided by 3 is equal to negative 7. And indeed, we get, when we plug, you know, negative 23 over 3 or negative 7 and 2/3 back into the original equation, we get two sides that match. And therefore, this is our final answer. This has been a checked solution to that equation. Now over here, we have our variable back on the left-hand side. Textbooks do tend to like to have that variable on the left more than the right, and so we get in the habit of always moving those numbers to the left, but we're not always moving our numbers to the left. We're moving those numbers away from the variable until we get it completely isolated. So on the left-hand side, we have, again, a positive 2/5. You often will have the variable first. I'm putting these constants in front of the term or in front of the variable because, well, you know, those are missed more often by my students. So I'm trying to go over some more of the difficult examples. So we want to undo this addition, this positive 2/5 that is with the x on the left. So the opposite of a positive 2/5 is to subtract 2/5. See, I just said the opposite again. The inverse math operation, the inverse of adding 2/5 to x is subtracting it. Anything minus itself is 0, negative 2 minus 2 is 0 over 5. Maybe let me go write that, 0 over 5. You cannot divide by 0, but you can divide into 0. Whenever 0 is in the numerator, that final fraction is going to be 0. But if this was 5 over 0, that would be undefined. But we can have 0 on the top, that answer is 0. So bringing down the x, we do not have common denominators. But I got plenty of room to write here, so I'm going to take, multiples of 4. 4, 8, 12, 16, 20, 24. Multiples of 5. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. There's my lowest common multiple, my LCM. 4 needs to get multiplied by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And 5 needs to get multiplied by 4. And that is going to give me 3 times 5 is 15. 4 times 5 is 20. Negative 2 times 4 is negative 8. And 5 times 4 is equal to 20. Now, bringing these together, subtracting now just the numerators, now that we have the common denominator, 15 minus 8 is equal to 7. And our final answer is x is equal to 7 over 20. You want to check that? Always want to check your work. Many teachers require it. So our check, positive 2 over 5, x, which we believe is 7 over 20. Is that going to make the left side? When I plug in that 7 over 20, will it make the left side or the equal to the right side, which is 3/4? I need a common denominator. Now, instead of doing the whole list here, this is 4 times 5 when you factor it. So this denominator has a factor of 5 and a factor of 4. This denominator only has a 5, so I need to introduce that factor of 4. So we're going to multiply 4 onto the numerator and denominator. Again, 4 over 4 is equal to 1, so I'm just multiplying by 1. I'm making the fraction look different. not changing its value. That's 8. That's 20. Bringing down the plus 7 over 20. Please note that I'm only doing one step at a time, by the way. Being very meticulous with my work, you should do that as well. It leads to much fewer mistakes. 8 times 7 is equal to 15. And now 15 is 3 times 5. 20 is 4 times 5. So the numerator and denominator both have a common factor of 5, and 5 divided by 5 is equal to 1. So we're left with a reduced value of 3/4, which is what the right-hand side was equal to. And that means that we have checked our solution. And there is how you solve one-step equations that deal with addition and subtraction, with a lot of review of fractions, because let's be honest, you know, I see a lot of students that unfortunately struggle with them, even though you really got it. There's a lot of day-to-day work that involves fractions, so please practice them. Please don't just grab your calculator as soon as you see one. It's going to weaken your math skills and make you struggle through classes that you'll take from here on out, and even finishing your Algebra 1 course. Now let's